Harper Audio presents Be More Chill by Ned Vizzini, read by Jesse Eisenberg. Part 1. Pre-Squip. 1. The room is bright and alive at 8:45 a.m. I can almost ignore Middleborough High School's zombie fluorescent lighting. Mr. Gretsch is up at his desk, a tall, bald head with wisps of hair and a beard. He's accompanied by a newspaper and a cactus. In about 20 seconds, he's going to take attendance. To my left is Jenna Rowland, the coolest girl in class. Jenna is already talking. She was like, "I'll only do it if you beat me in pool." And then, of course, she intentionally lost in pool. What a slut. Jenna likes to talk about her friend Elizabeth, who is a real slut. In fact, when I think about it, Jenna never talks about her family or TV or when work is due or the ins and outs of procuring concert tickets like most girls. She just talks about how Elizabeth is a slut. You should have seen what she was wearing. It was like a garbage bag with a condom on top. Brr, Anne laughs. Anne is the second coolest girl in class, which is math. She sits in front of me, so she's always twisting back in her chair to talk to Jenna, which reinforces the fact that Jenna is coolest and she is second coolest. Girls are very territorial. Mr. Gretsch clears his throat from the front of the room. Abby? Here. Asu? Here. Atborough? Here. Azu, not Asu. Mr. Gretsch absentmindedly cups his cactus. This never seems to hurt him. Here. Coniglia? Christine raises her hand. I look over at her. She looks beautiful. Here. I look down. Duvaknovich? Here. Garansky? Here. Here. Oh, yeah. Here comes the fun part. The part that has been stressing me since they started taking attendance in fifth grade. I can't say here in response to my name. It confuses teachers. I raise my hand quietly and say, "Present." Somebody snickers up by the front of the room. Are they snickering at me? Are they? Oh, can never be too sure. I pull out one of my pre-printed humiliation sheets, write the date up top, and put a tally mark next to the snicker category. I cover the page tightly so Jenna can't see. Then I retune my ears to listen for copycat snickering. 2. The humiliation sheets have developed a lot over the years, with a host of different categories, but the current model has snicker, laugh, snotty comment, refusal to return a head nod, the standard form of greeting at Middleborough High, refusal to return a verbal greeting, refusal to touch hands, public denial of formally agreed upon opinion, refusal to repeat a joke, and mortification event, a catch-all. I use the humiliation sheets to keep track of my social status in a concrete, quantitative way. They are my secret, totally. I make sure no one sees them as I fill them up with tally marks every day. I hate tally marks. Up front, Mr. Gretsch writes K on the board. K sucks in math. Once you see it, you might as well ignore everything and save yourself. Mr. Gretsch can't hear on account of he's, well, old, so Jenna keeps talking and I keep listening. Okay, and then Elizabeth was like, "Where can we go? I don't have a car like you." And the guy says, Jenna puts on a low voice, "Come and sit on this pipe, babe." And she went. Unbelievable. Anne eats it up, brr, craning her neck to suck in every word. It's far enough into the school year, mid-October, for kids to have stopped talking about summer. The big story was that Jake Dillinger had sex with this model from Czechoslovakia who was dating his dad, which I believe. Jake can do anything. Mostly people are talking about the parties of the past weekend or the PSATs, which are coming up. There's also scattered chatter about the Halloween dance. I hear Brianna has, like, 5 boys lined up, because with football players, you don't know if one of them is going to sprain his ankle and not be able to dance. And up talks. Jenna gives back cold silence. That happened to me in junior high. My then-boyfriend broke his leg, and I had to dance with him while he was on crutches and a cast, and it was so horrible. I tune my ears from Jenna Ann to other pockets of activity in the room. Mark Jackson and this other kid, his name is actually Jackson Marks, discuss video games. Rob works out a math problem, probably something post-calculus, while picking at his mouth, ear, and nose as if he has them on shuffle. Barbary explains how everyone has to call him Dr. Barbary now because he ordered a PhD off the internet. And Christine, quiet in her invisible pod up by the front of the room, just looks pretty. "Ooh, I heard Christine Coniglia has a new stalker," Jenna says. "Whoa! Jenna!" Anne whispers like she's protecting something. "He's right there!" "Double whoa!" I sit quietly, stiff. Calm. Calm. My head is turned, so they must not think I'm listening, but I'm always listening. I'm wired. I peek at Jenna. She eyes me as if I'm a mildly interesting object between her and the clock. I turn back. "Yeah, that's him," she says to Anne. "I heard he wrote her a letter." "I never wrote any letter. I never even said anything to Christine, not once, except don't press C7, the Nutrigrain bars get stuck in this machine. That one time out by the student union office where the Nutrigrain bars get stuck in the machine. Because I can talk to Christine. I just look at her and think about her a lot because she's beautiful, you know? I mean, she's intelligent and sweet and everything else that a girl is supposed to be to offset her beauty, but even if she were idiotic and mean, she'd still be beautiful and I'd still be contorted." "He is weird," Jenna says. This is a bad day for me to start hearing this stuff. In my pocket is a Shakespeare made of chocolate. Okay, like one of those Easter bunny chocolates, but in the shape of Shakespeare. And I was going to give it to Christine today at our first play rehearsal. I clutch it. Jenna whispers something I can't quite catch. I slide my elbow across my humiliation sheet and put a tally mark under mortification event, because I don't have a specific category for people whispering about me. I should. Just then, Mr. Gretsch does the stupid classic high school move, and I can't even believe it's being done to me.
"And Jeremy, can you tell us what that angle would be?"
My notebook isn't open. It's being used as a humiliation sheet shield. My neurons aren't depolarizing. I learned that in bio. Mortification event number 2. 3. At lunch, I seek out my best friend, Michael Mell. Michael sits in a different place in the cafeteria every day. Sometimes the indoor part with the long formica tables, sometimes the outdoor part with the scarred picnic benches and giant bees. But you can always spot him because he's a tall white boy with a white boy afro and huge headphones. They have a cord coming off them that's spiraled like an old phone cord. The headphones let him plunk down anywhere, with the jocks or Warhammer nerds or at one of the girl tables, although Michael only sits with Asian girls. No one bothers him when he has them on because he's obviously got important things on his mind.
"What's up?" I say as I approach.
Michael doesn't listen to a thing in those headphones during lunch. He just likes how they feel on his head. He says, wolfing down a fish patty sandwich with cheese and chocolate milk.
"Sup?"
"Big problems," I say. I pull the chocolate Shakespeare out of my pocket. It's wrapped in Victorian-era style foil. Plop it on the table and prop my elbows up to either side of it. I don't think I could give this to Christine.
Yeah?
"Michael."
"Yeah?"
"You want to finish that?" Michael smiles and lets chewed fish cheese roll through the gap in his teeth. It plats onto the tray in front of him. "Crackhead," I laugh. "People are going to see you."
"Oh, no,"
Michael says, his Adam's apple bobs up and down as his food slides away.
"Yeah, so,
He drinks milk, wipes his mouth on the back of his wrist.
"What's with Christine? You pussying out?"
"Yeah, well, I haven't touched my food. It's bad."
"What's bad? I totally know how it is. Did you say something dumb to her?"
"Well, no, but people think I did, which is basically the same thing."
"No," Michael says, working on an orange ice cream bar now. "You doing something and people thinking that you did it are actually really different."
"Well, people think I gave her a letter." Michael's body rocks. He grins.
"I've got your letter. You've got my song."
I punch him in the shoulder. "Ow! No Weezer, okay?"
"I'll try." Michael folds his hands.
"So, who thinks you wrote Christine a letter?"
"Jenna Rowland. She also said I was her new stalker."
"You're such a girl." Michael gets up and slides his tray into a nearby garbage can.
"So what? Does Christine care? That's who's important, right?"
"Yeah, she's who's important, but she's not the only thing that matters in this whole situation," I say, making circles with my hands to emphasize situation. "It's like, do I still give this to her or not? Will it seem too stalkerish?"
"Jeremy."
Michael fixes buttons on his shirt. "That chocolate Shakespeare is genius. She's gonna love chocolate because everybody does, except for those weird people who only like chips." Michael glances one table away at a red-haired girl eating chips. "And she's in a Shakespeare play with you, so obviously she's gonna like Shakespeare." "But what if she thinks I'm an obsessed loser?" I started on the bean salad on my tray. It came cold, but feels colder.
"Dude," Michael says, "think of how you'll feel if you don't give it to her. Think of how you'll feel at home tonight, jerking off, having missed your chance."
"Oh, yeah, well, duh, I'll feel like I do all the time, like I feel whenever I can't dial a phone number or dance at a dance or hold a hand right, like I'm used to feeling. Like shit."
"Right, so give it to her." "Yo, tall ass, could you maybe sit or move from the garbage can?" Rich says to Michael. Rich has come on the scene, that's what he does best.
He's shorter than us, but very built. He has blonde hair with a streak of red in the back, like a rooster. Michael moves aside, and Rich dumps his whole tray, including the actual tray, into the trash. He eyes us.
"What?" Punks.
4. At the end of the day, I walk Middleborough's elongated and well-painted hall. My school has one giant hallway that you enter in the middle of, so the whole place is like the Great Wall of Metuchen, New Jersey, with the echoes of the swim team at one end and the sound of the theater door opening and closing at the other end, where I'm going. So far, in high school, I too have an extensive middle school career. I've been in The Tempest and You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown, to rave reviews, both times, from my mom. I like everything about school plays. Being at school after school, learning my lines in the bathroom, how the performance always seems totally screwed up a week before it goes on but then comes together at the last minute, how the second show always manages to be better than the first, how everyone takes their bow at the end and the parents are standing, showing off their digital camcorders, and your costume is hot, but you figure, okay, that's the price of my art, and then bam, cast party. I love cast parties. I've never been to one, actually, truthfully, but I'm sure they're great. Hey, you're in this play? I ask Mark Jackson from math as I sit down next to him. Mark's my friend, sort of. Yeah, I'm in this dilly deal, he says. He's playing Game Boy SP. What's it called again? A Midsummer Night's Dream, I say. You don't even know the name of your own play? Only I don't say that. Midsummer Night's Dream, gotcha. I sit down two places from him in a seat that looks like it was stained with condom residue. Not that I would know, except for that one time in my room when I was messing around with one to see what it would look like in the mirror. Hot, hot to death, Mark says. What? I'm talking to the game, yo, mind your beeswax. I look over at Mark's game, or, beeswax, as the case may be. It looks like he's driving an SUV on underground train tracks, shooting a high-powered rifle at homeless people. No peeking, Dorcas Malorcas, Mark says, snatching his Game Boy away, imperiling his driving and shooting. I'm the only one in the school with Cap 3. You gotta pay me $5 to look at it. What's Cap 3? Kill all people. 3. You never heard of kill all people? What's wrong with you? Mark eyes me. I sit silent, keeping my head and mouth steady, staring ahead. After a few seconds, Mark slides down a seat. Like I have herpes. Or lupus, right? Lupus. Then I move down a row. Fuck, Jeremy, you don't have to be such a bitch, he remarks as I take my new seat. Just then, Christine, uncharacteristically late for something, walks down the aisle past us. She rolls her eyes at Mark, and while she's doing it, it is possible that they land on my person for a millisecond or two. Wow. When's the teacher getting here? Oh! Mr. Reyes shrieks from the entrance to the theater. Mwah! Greetings all! I'm not sure you realize it, but I have a very powerful falsetto voice. Bah! Damn, this dude is fruitaliciously homorific, Mark says behind me. Little digital homeless people groan as they die on his Game Boy SP. It is wonderful to see you here. Mr. Reyes gets on stage behind a mic, which he does not need. I am glad to have such a captive audience for my voice. I am also very glad to have such a wonderful cast. We are going to have a great time in the play. Mr. Reyes is tall and skinny with no facial hair. He wears a suit and tie. He teaches English for his day job. So, let's see who's here, and I will give you all your parts. Jeremy here? Yes, I get up. There's no need to stand, you must simply know that you have gotten the role of Lysander. This is a very demanding role that will take much of your time. Thank you, Mr. Reyes. Jake? Jake Dillinger is in this play too? Guess it isn't enough to be on the football team and nail a Czechoslovakian model and be the leader of the SU. Down in front, he shifts in his seat slightly to acknowledge Mr. Reyes. You are going to be Demetrius. Another tough role. Get ready to memorize muchly. Cool, Jake says. Puck, where is my puck? Christine Caniglia. Christine is now down front near Jake. All I see is her blonde hair. You're kidding, she squirts. I'm Puck. You, young lady, are Puck. Yes, Christine jumps out of her seat, pumping her fist. Everyone eyes her with respect and swelled up cutesy pride. Or maybe that's just me. When girls get happy and jump out of their seats, like on The Price is Right, it's sweet to watch. Don't get too excited, Christine. It's a disgusting number of lines. Ma! Mr. Reyes moves on through Hermia, Helena, Titania, Bottom, and about a dozen other people. Mark, behind me with his Game Boy, gets to be some kind of cross-dressing elf. That's comforting. Okay, those are the roles. Now we must have the read-through. Ladies, fetch 2 metal chairs each and bring them on stage. What? The girls down in front look confused. It's funny how they look confused from behind, with their shoulders bunched up. Christine is the only one I hear. Wait, how come we have to get the chairs? Come, come, it's a trade-off each time, Mr. Reyes says. The men will be on chair fetching tomorrow. Speaking of which, men,
Pick a representative to go to the teacher's lounge and have them microwave my hot pocket.
For the whole play, I ask? I don't want to get stuck with that job.
No, Jeremy, just for today. Next time the girls will pick someone to go.
I don't understand, Mark says behind me, actually pausing cap three. Could you explain that again, please?
Mr. Reyes says. On day one, the girls will set up the chairs and the guys will pick a representative to get my hot pocket. On day two, the guys will set up the chairs and the girls will pick a representative to get my hot pocket. Then it repeats. Does anyone have a question about this?
Yes, of course.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.